Our next speaker, the last speaker for this session before we do a panel discussion, will be Stefan Everling from the University of Western Ontario. Stefan.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for inviting me, Brad and Bea, especially since I really don't work about development. So you're going to see that. But I'm going to show you today data from experiments that we've been doing for the past 3 years, where we've started to do resting state fMRI in monkeys. So this is our species here, the macaque monkey. And obviously, macaque monkeys have been used for a long time in neuroscience. And for most of the stuff, people, and we do the same thing, have done microelectrode recordings in these animals. And it's a fantastic technique, right? I mean, the spatial resolution and the temporal resolution is just phenomenal. What we can do here is with the technique here, so for example, this is actually the recording trace from recordings in the superior colliculus on the monkey. So each of these little tick marks here is the time when the neuron discharges an action potential after a stimulus is presented. So we can record exactly the time when this neuron fires. At the same time, we can record here the local field potential. So it's a really phenomenal temporal resolution. Now, in human studies, as we've heard a lot today, the common technique really is now used, now is functional imaging. And in functional imaging, we get these types of maps. So how do we relate the findings that we get from electrophysiology in monkeys to imaging in human studies? And I'm going to illustrate this on the oculomotor system, because that's the area I've been working on for quite a while now. So we know from experiments in the 80s that there is this area in the frontal cortex. In the monkey, it's in the anterior bank of the arcuate sulcus. It's called the frontal eye fields. So this is an area where, when we record here, we find cells that have saccade-related activity. If you stimulate, we can evoke saccadic eye movements, contralateral eye movements. And if you make lesions here, we impair eye movements. So a similar area exists in humans. So that's a paper from Bea here, so seminal paper, where she showed that in simple eye movement tasks, you also get activation here in the frontal eye fields in humans. And you can probably appreciate here, so the frontal eye fields in humans are a lot further posterior than they are here in the monkey. So, let me just go to the next slide. Yeah. So there's been a lot of excitement, probably starting about 15 years ago, about doing functional imaging in monkeys, so task-based functional imaging in monkeys. So this is a paper here from Koyama. So he did just simple visually guided saccades in monkeys and in human subjects, and you can see that you get actually very similar maps here. So you get similar areas that are activated. So maybe surprising to a lot of people is that this, I would say, this field has not really taken off, task-based imaging in monkeys. There are a number of papers, especially stuff where you have the animal and you just present him with a stream of visual objects or auditory stimuli. That is fairly easy to do, okay? But as soon as you actually put the animal in there and you actually expect the animal to do a task in this environment, it's very difficult. So really very few studies. So we've tried this several years ago, and we've done something with pro and anti-saccades. Doug Nunes is going to talk about the tasks this afternoon. And we managed to get data, but it was a pain. So it's just because the animals do not perform every task in the scanner, right? So you have to exclude so much data. Movement artifacts is a huge problem. Even though we keep the head fixed, they can just move around, turn around, and they do this, right? Even if they don't move a lot, it's enough to really render your data unusable. So that's the reason why we then decided a few years ago, well, let's try something new. See, can we actually use resting state imaging and do something with this technique? And so really the bigger question here, so is the macaque monkey a useful animal model for resting state fMRI? So what we do, so we have two scanners at our facility. We have a 7 Tesla scanner. This is the scanner that we use for the animals. We use lightly anesthetized macaque monkeys, And we do this so we don't have any training requirements. Okay, so we just 1% isoflurane, so it's very light anesthesia. They usually head fixed in addition to that. So we have no problem with any movement artifacts. So, and I'm going to show you some data today from human subjects, and that's just a typical 3T Siemens TIM-Trio scanner here. So for the animals, we've developed our own chair here and our own head coil. So it's a 5-channel transceive head coil, where we get actually very good resolution now. So we are now at 1 millimeter isovoxel for EPIs. So I'm going to show you the first data where we did a comparison of the frontal eye fields in the monkeys and in humans. So in humans, so seed-based analysis, we put seeds here at the junction of the precentral sulcus, superior frontal sulcus, where the frontal eye fields are located based on task-based fMRI in humans, and then in the monkey here in the anterior bank of the arcuate sulcus. So, and this was initially done on 6 animals, and this is where we actually had a poor resolution. It wasn't 1 millimeter isovox, it was, I think, 1.3 millimeters or so. So if you run this, you actually get surprising. I mean, I was actually totally blown away how good this looked based on all our task-based stuff, which really didn't look that impressive. So this looked actually really nice. So because especially if you compare this now with tracer studies, so it's an 87 tracer study, we actually get all the areas here that are connected with the seed region. And somebody has said that earlier today that resting state does not measure monosynaptic connections. And that is true, but I would say the majority of the areas that you get are probably areas that are monosynaptic connected. At least based on our result, it really looks like that. You get a few of the, well, especially the other hemisphere, you get a lot of areas that we know they're not connected, but within the hemisphere, you get a lot of areas that really have anatomical connections. So this is how it looks in humans, and a lot of you have seen these maps. And even there, I was totally surprised because this really looks like every task-based saccade map I've ever seen, really. So it doesn't matter whether you compare memory-guided saccades with visually-guided saccades, or whether you compare anti-saccades with pro-saccades, saccades with fixation, it almost looks all the same. So this really, to me, really raised the questions, what have we been doing so far, really, if we get the same maps. Let me just go back here. So this is a direct comparison here. Here are the humans, here are the monkeys. And there are a couple of differences. So one thing what you actually see in the monkeys, we see a stronger bilateral connectivity in monkeys than in humans. So in humans here, in the human data set here, you can see it's a lot of connectivity here, for example, with the left FEF seed with parietal cortex, but it's not that much, so it's a weaker connectivity with the other hemisphere. So we seem to have stronger bilateral connectivity in monkeys than what we have in humans. What we then can do is, so this is actually, so now the whole thing is on a flat map here, in human data, here the monkey data. You can now actually play around and you can project the monkey data on a human brain and the human data on the monkey brain. So we used landmarks that Gio Bahn had previously identified, and then we added a few other landmarks, here the FEF, prefrontal cortex, supplementary eye fields, and so forth. And if you do this, so these are the macaque data. So we project them here on the human brain. Human data, project them on the macaque brain. And you can see that there are actually a lot of similarities. So if you compare this map here with this map, it looks fairly similar. We get more parietal activation here in the humans than we see in the monkey. But overall, you get a really nice correspondence. So this might be actually a way to establish, this is just a first step, but really might be a way to establish a correspondence between the human brain and the monkey brain that we can use for mapping purposes then. So next question we really want to ask, so how good is really the spatial resolution that we get with resting state fMRI? So this is where we've been using now the 1 millimeter isovoxel data. And again, we focused on the frontal eye field here, and just because we know from electrophysiology that there's a nice map in the frontal eye fields. So if you stimulate the lateral part in the FEF, you evoke very small saccades. If you stimulate the medial part in FEF, you get large saccades. Okay, so that's been shown like long time, 69, 85, so very nice here, very large saccades here, so it's a nice mapping. And we also know from tracer studies in monkeys that these two regions here, so the medial and the lateral FEF, actually have different anatomical connectivity. So the medial part that's triggering the large saccades has lots of connectivity, so the anatomical connectivity with the parietal cortex here, with area MT, MST, with the lateral FEF that's coding the small saccades, has a lot of projections from object areas like area TE, TEO, and so forth. So we want to see whether we can find the same thing with resting state FMI. So we put small seeds. For this, we had a data set of 5 monkeys, put very small seeds in here, medial lateral, and this is what we get. So for the medial seeds, so this is again, so this is for the large saccades, we get this type of structural or functional connectivity. So you see there's actually connectivity here with areas, premotor cortex, motor cortex, parietal cortex here. And if we look at the lateral seat here, we see that we find a lot of functional connectivity more with areas that involve like object processing. I'm going to show you, yeah, so I have the whole thing overlaid actually, so on the flat map. So in red, these are areas that have functional connectivity with the medial FEF seat. Green are areas that have functional connectivity with the lateral FEF seat. And yellow are areas that have connectivity with both. And you can really see very nicely, so that for the large saccades here, you get, we get motor cortex, premotor cortex, these areas, area 7A. For the lateral FEF seed, we really get all these areas, so V4, TE, so TE, TEO, and so forth. So even though these seeds are really only like 4 millimeters or so apart, we get a completely different functional connectivity. So I think that's actually, it's quite powerful. And this maps really quite nicely with the with what we know from traditional tracer studies. How much time do you have? Okay, good. So, and this, these basically, these, because what we're arguing in this paper that these are actually two different networks that we have here. And these two different networks might actually underlie the behavior that we see in humans when they do, so this is now human data, when humans do certain everyday tasks. So this is something for Mary Hayhoe and Dana Ballard, where people, I think in this case, they make a sandwich, okay? So you see a lot of eye movements, small amplitude eye movements at one point here, and then you get large saccades towards a different object, so in this case, the plate. So, but essentially what you get, you get the sequence of small saccades, number of small saccades, large saccades, which usually are also associated then with a head movement or even with a whole body movement. And then you get again the sequence of small saccades. That's the same thing what Randy Flanagan also showed in this object avoidance task. So you get these like number of small saccades here, then you get a big movement again, in this case, so it's actually it's the arm movement, and then you get small saccades, so we get the sequence. So what I want to talk about in the end here is whether we can use resting state FMI the monkey to actually parcellate areas. So I'm going to focus here on the prefrontal cortex. Most of you have probably seen these maps here. I mean, really, this goes back here to Broadman, 1905, a map here by Walker, Petraeus, and Pandya. And what you can see is actually, or what this is supposed to illustrate is that there's a resemblance between these different maps, which are all based on cytoarchitectonic features. But they all look very different. They have certain differences, really. I mean, for example, here, Broadman called this entire thing Area 9, so he actually didn't find Area 46 in monkeys. Walker, in turn, divided this here into an Area 46, and then had the Area 9 here. And Petraeus and Pandya further subdivided these areas into Area 946, then here, Area 46, and so forth. So this is actually a very difficult technique to segment an area based on psychoarchitectonic borders. And in a recent publication here, in a book from Passingham and Wise, they actually almost went back and just divided the prefrontal cortex into, five different areas, I believe. Just the caudal, dorsal, ventral, median, and orbital area. Yeah. And they basically say that these areas might have more functional relevance than the different cytoarchitectonic areas. So what we did is we took our resting data set now from 11 animals, and we just did a very simple cluster analysis on this. And this is what we got. And obviously with the cluster analysis, the question is always, so where do you put the threshold? And what we decided here to put the threshold here at 5 clusters, because once we go beyond 5 clusters in our data set, it breaks down. So we lose the bilateral, the similarities between the left and the right hemisphere, and then also clusters become discontinuous. So, but doing this here, so we have our, what we call here, we have a caudal cluster, a lateral cluster, a rostral cluster, a ventral cluster, and a dorsal cluster. And these areas here correspond quite nicely with tracer studies. So for example, if you look at this one here, so this is a tracer study in the ventral prefrontal cortex here, and here you see all the labeled cells. This corresponds quite nicely here to this cluster. Even here, like the labeling that we see on the orbital surface here from that. Or for example, an injection here, in the orbital cortex here, fits quite nicely with this ventral cluster here. Look at this here. So it seems to be quite nice correspondence between the size of these clusters and the intrinsic connectivity in the prefrontal cortex. So I'm going to rush a little bit through this here. What we then can do is, so we can take these clusters and basically compute the whole brain connectivity for these different seeds. So basically take this entire area as a seed and look at the whole brain connectivity. You can see that it's fundamentally different, really, for these different clusters. For example, here in this cluster, which includes the frontal eye fields and the caudal part of the principal sulcus, this is an area where we get a lot of activation, functional connectivity here with the parietal cortex. But in other areas, we get a lot of functional connectivity with the superior temporal sulcus, for example, and so forth. So I mean, so we argue that these are really functionally different areas. Last thing, because we use anesthetized animals, and I always get the question, so I mean, how does anesthesia change it? And again, I don't have the comparison to the awake animal, but what we've done is we manipulated here in a recent study that we submitted the level of isoflurane. So all stuff I've shown you before is done at 1% isoflurane. And so we now actually change the concentration, go higher and higher and higher. So this is getting a dangerous concentration. So one animal, we had to stop this because the animal was stopped breathing. But what you can see is that up to a concentration of about 1.5% isoflurane, so this is like a seed, for example, here in premotor cortex, you still get bilateral connectivity. After 1.5%, the connectivity breaks down. So then we don't get any connectivity anymore between the hemispheres. But we still, even at these very high concentrations of 2.75% isoflurane, we still see functional connectivity within the same hemisphere. So we just summarize this. So we think that resting state fMRI is a useful tool for identifying potentially task-related areas and for comparative mapping. And we think that macaque monkeys provide a powerful model, animal model, for studying the anatomical and neurophysiological basis of resting state fMRI. Unfortunately, the data that we currently have are not good enough to show you, but we are also now doing combined electrophysiological recordings with resting state fMRI in these animals. But it's probably going to take another 3 or 4 months before I have some good data there. So lastly, I would like to thank the people who are actually doing all this work. So this was really my graduate student, Matt Hutchison, who's now doing a postdoc with Randy Buckner. Sahant did the study where we looked at the medial and lateral seat and frontal eye fields. It's my long-term collaborator and friend, Ravi Menon, director of our imaging facility, and Joe Getty, who actually operates our scanners, and funding here from CIHR. Thank you.